Graves' disease is an autoimmune disease which primarily affects the thyroid gland. It's the most common cause of hyperthyroidism. Approximately 60-80% of all hyperthyroid cases are caused by Graves' disease. Also, as most autoimmune disorders, Graves' disease mostly affects women. In Graves' disease, initially immune break causes formation of thyroid-stimulating antibodies. Thyroid-stimulating antibodies cause hyperstimulation of thyroid gland. In response to this, thyroid gland begin to overproduce thyroid hormones. So first of all, hyperthyroidism develops, and in addition to this, thyroid-stimulating antibodies cause overstimulation of fibroblasts that results in increase in extracellular matrix production, and this causes edema. So all symptoms of Graves' disease are related to two pathological states. Most symptoms are caused by hyperthyroidism, but also we have symptoms caused by overstimulation of fibroblasts, as myxedema and ophthalmopathy. So let's explain the pathogenesis of Graves' disease. So here we have thyroid gland. Thyroid gland consists of follicular cells and colloid. Also, we have pituitary gland that provides regulation of the thyroid gland. Pituitary gland produces thyroid-stimulating hormone. This hormone searches for a thyroid-stimulating hormone receptors, and such receptors are present on follicular cells of the thyroid gland. So, thyroid-stimulating hormone comes to thyroid gland and binds to thyroid-stimulating hormone receptors. This results in stimulation of follicular cells that in response to this increase the production of thyroid hormones into the blood. We have two major thyroid hormones, it's triiodothyronine and thyroxine. We know them as T3 and T4. Important that we have reciprocal regulation. The idea is that T3 and T4 inhibit the production of thyroid-stimulating hormone by pituitary gland. So by this we can maintain normal level of thyroid hormones in the blood. But sometimes something can go wrong. Infections, drugs, or oxidative stress can cause damage to follicular cells of the thyroid gland. And this injury to thyroid gland can also a little bit change normal structure of thyroid-stimulating hormone receptor. We call this post-translational modification. And now, when cell dies, modified thyroid-stimulating hormone receptor is released into the blood. Macrophages consume this receptor and then present some parts of this receptor on MHC2 receptor to T helpers. The logic is that macrophages want to know, is this receptor normal material or it's something pathogenic? T helpers scan receptor and in normal condition, T helper recognize receptor as a normal substance, and thereby they do not trigger inflammation. But if it's modified receptor, there is totally different story. Because T helpers cannot recognize receptor in modified state. For T helpers, modified receptor is totally new substance, and thereby they think that it's antigen. In response to any antigen, T helpers immediately becomes activated, and subsequently they produce interleukin-6, which activates B lymphocytes. When B lymphocytes become activated, they begin to produce autoantibodies against thyroid-stimulating hormone receptors. Autoantibodies income to thyroid-stimulating hormone receptors on thyroid gland, and instead of destroying receptors, autoantibodies bind to thyroid-stimulating hormone receptors, and with binding, they markedly increase the activity of follicular cells. So thyroid-stimulating hormone receptors autoantibodies act like thyroid-stimulating hormone. They stimulate secretion of follicular cells. But the major difference is that the production of thyroid-stimulating hormone by pituitary gland is under strict reciprocal regulation, so we cannot overproduce thyroid-stimulating hormone. But the production of thyroid-stimulating hormone receptors autoantibodies is uncontrollable. So immune break causes massive production of thyroid-stimulating hormone receptors autoantibodies, and thus we have massive overstimulation of thyroid gland by autoantibodies. and overstimulation of follicular cells results in overproduction of thyroid hormones, and increasing amount of thyroid hormones in the blood we call hyperthyroidism. And hyperthyroidism is a major pathological manifestation of Graves' disease. Also, recall that we have reciprocal regulation of pituitary gland. So now, if the amount of thyroid hormones increase, the production of thyroid-stimulating hormone by pituitary gland decreases, because there is no point to additionally stimulate the production of thyroid hormones if thyroid hormones level is already substantially higher than normal. But in addition to hyperthyroidism, we have symptoms which are related to edema. So how edema develops? It turns out that the second site of action of thyroid-stimulating hormone receptors autoantibodies are fibroblasts. Recall that the function of fibroblasts is to produce collagen and hyaluronic acid. And hyaluronic acid attracts water. By this we form extracellular matrix. Thyroid-stimulating hormone receptors autoantibodies bind to fibroblasts and activate them. And fibroblast in activated state we call myofibroblast. The major feature of myofibroblast is tremendous production capacity. Myofibroblast produce massive amount of collagen and hyaluronic acid. And because of this conversion, the total amount of extracellular matrix increase. And because hyaluronic acid attracts water, the amount of water in the tissues also increase. And increasing amount of fluid in the tissues we call edema. So the second major pathological manifestation of Graves' disease is edema. So what are the symptoms of Graves' disease? All symptoms are caused by thyroid-stimulating hormone receptors autoantibodies. First of all, autoantibodies cause overstimulation of follicular cells. In response to overstimulation, the size of the follicular cells increase, and thereby the size of the thyroid gland increase. We call this condition goiter. The larger is the size of the thyroid gland, the higher is the blood flow to thyroid gland, and this creates so-called thyroid gland brood. Also, thyroid gland can become so large that it can cause compression of laryngeal nerve, and this can cause hoarseness. And also, goiter can compress esophagus, and this may manifest with dysphagia. Overstimulation of follicular cells causes overproduction of thyroid hormones, and increase in thyroid hormones through reciprocal regulation causes decrease in production of thyroid-stimulating hormone by pituitary gland. So the combination of high thyroid hormones level and low thyroid-stimulating hormone level is a specific feature of Graves' disease. Massive amount of thyroid hormones cause very potent stimulation of sympathetic nervous system. And overstimulation of sympathetic nervous system causes sweating. And also it can cause increase in heart rate and arrhythmias, especially atrial fibrillation. Also, massive amount of thyroid hormones cause overstimulation of central nervous system, and this can manifest as nervousness, tremor, hyperreflexia, and hyperkinesia. Also, thyroid hormones stimulate thermogenesis, and increase in thermogenesis cause weight loss and heat intolerance. In addition to this, thyroid hormones increase gut motility, and overstimulation of gut motility causes diarrhea. The second site of action of thyroid-stimulating hormone receptor autoantibodies are fibroblasts. Autoantibodies convert fibroblasts into myofibroblasts, and myofibroblasts begin to produce massive amount of hyaluronic acid and collagen, and together they form huge amount of extracellular matrix, and increasing extracellular matrix causes edema. Most commonly, it's pretibial myxedema and proptosis, which is a form of ophthalmopathy. So here we can see an example of three stages of myxedema. And as we see, long-term Graves' disease can end up in gross deformity of the lower limb. Here we see three stages of Graves' ophthalmopathy: mild, moderate, and severe. As we see, orbitopathy is caused by severe edema of the muscle tissue. So, what are the diagnostic criteria for Graves' disease? First of all, it's the presence of thyroid-stimulating hormone receptor autoantibodies. As we said, immune break causes formation of thyroid-stimulating hormone receptor autoantibodies, and they act on thyroid gland and fibroblast. So without autoantibodies, Graves' disease will not develop, so it's a major criteria. The second criteria is the presence of thyroid nodules on ultrasound. Recall that stimulation of thyroid gland by thyroid-stimulating hormone receptor autoantibodies cause enlargement of follicular cells that results in formation of a so-called hyperplastic follicular cells. So on the left we have normal thyroid. As we see, follicular cells are nicely organized in one line, and the central part is taken by the colloid. But in Graves' disease, because follicular cells are enlarged, now there is no space for all follicular cells, and because of this, they begin to form folds. And these pseudopapillary infoldings basically invade colloid space. So generally, there is increase in follicular space and decrease in colloid space. And hyperplastic follicular cells form nodules that we can see on ultrasound. So on the left, we have normal thyroid gland. We see isthmus, right lobe and left lobe. And also important that thyroid tissue is homogeneous, which means that the density is approximately the same in every part of the thyroid gland. But on right images, we can see that some local areas have increased density, and in normal state, this thyroid area should have the same density as other thyroid tissue. The same features we can see on the third image, where we also have area of increased density, and in normal state, we see that the same area should have the same density as other thyroid tissue. And this local area of increased density is a sign of a thyroid nodule. On these images, we again see local areas with very high density compared to other thyroid tissue. So by ultrasound, we can determine the local areas of increased density that tell us that most probably it's a thyroid nodules. Now, if we determine thyroid nodules, we are interested in how big they are. Because the bigger the thyroid nodule, the higher is the chance that it can be a malignancy. So if nodules are less than 2 cm, serology and ultrasound is enough. But if nodules are larger than 2 cm, then we are afraid of malignancy, and because of this, we have to perform isotope scan. Isotope scan measures how much radioactive iodine is taken up by the thyroid gland in a certain period of time. The logic is that to produce thyroid hormones, thyroid gland requires iodine. So the higher the production of thyroid hormones, the higher the iodine uptake. And because it's radioactive iodine, we can determine the amount of iodine that thyroid gland uptake by the density of thyroid gland on a scan. If iodine uptake is normal, then just moderate amount of iodine accumulates inside the thyroid, and we will see thyroid gland that has moderate density. But if person has Graves' disease, thyroid gland is very active, and because thyroid gland uptake a lot of iodine, massive amount of radioactive iodine accumulates inside the thyroid gland, and we can see this as areas of thyroid gland that have very high density. So on this image, we also see high density of the thyroid gland that is caused by high iodine uptake. And high iodine uptake occurs when thyroid gland is extremely active, which is the case in Graves' disease. On this image, we see no uptake of iodine at all, which is the case in destructive thyrotoxicosis, where thyroid gland gets destroyed. On next image, we see local areas of high density, which tell us about toxic adenoma. The major difference with Graves' disease is that in Graves' disease, there is diffuse increase in density, and in toxic adenoma, it's local, which means that some cells uptake more and they form nodule, and other cells uptake less. And on the last image, we can see really severe Graves' disease that is accompanied by multiple nodules formation. We call this toxic multinodular goiter. And by thyroid-stimulating hormone level, we determine the state of the thyroid. If thyroid-stimulating hormone level is normal, it's autoimmunity, which means that thyroid production capacity is normal. But in Graves' disease, thyroid-stimulating hormone level is typically low or very low. If thyroid-stimulating hormone level is low, but thyroid hormone level is normal, we call this subclinical hyperthyroidism. If condition progress, the level of thyroid hormones will increase. And typically, initially, we can determine increase in triiodothyronine. The state when we have low thyroid-stimulating hormone level and increase in T3, we call T3 toxicosis. And in severe Graves' disease, we have low thyroid-stimulating hormone level combined with high T3 and T4. How do we treat Graves' disease? According to the current guidelines, we have two major approaches. The first step is drugs. It's dionamides, metimazole and carbimazole. Basically, it's the same drug but in different forms. Metimazole is the active form and carbimazole is inactive form. If dionamides do not help, we use radioactive iodine. And in severe cases of Graves' disease, especially if we determine multiple nodules, we use thyroidectomy. As alternative drugs, we can use propyltiouracil and beta blockers. So here we can see that to dionamides, we include metimazole, carbimazole and propyltiouracil. If dionamides do not help, we use radioactive iodine. And the last option is total thyroidectomy.